So guys, my name is Chad.
My name is Cameron Fasola.
I'm Andy.
And we're about half of our team. The rest of our team is sitting right here. And first off, I got a question for you guys. How many of you guys are grill masters? How many of you guys like to cook? With the spatula especially. Grilling out there, get some nice barbecue going on. Okay, I was hoping for a bit more, but that's okay. Well, you know, as you can know, it's a little dark outside, and some of you guys might be a little hungry, right? But you know, you go out there, you're carrying your meat, you're in your food, and it's realizing that's gonna be a bit difficult. You know, some of you may wear a headlamp while you're grilling out there at the true store. Some of you guys want to use your phone, but whatever it may be, we realized that this was a problem and we wanted to fix it. So that's what came up with the sunset spatula. So here's what we're talking about. Here's our performance to goals, and that's going to go into four different areas of our product, the process, the packaging, and the finances. Then we'll go into about the lessons learned, our future business and scale-up opportunities, as well as improvements, open up to any questions, and lastly, show our video. And I really want this to be interactive, so if you guys want to ask a question right away, feel free to raise it and be happy to answer it. Cool. All right, so a bit about our product. So as I mentioned earlier, we wanted something that we can use while grilling at night, but we'll be honest that this is not the first product that's out on the market right now. However, we want to be competitively priced, but also do something better. So it has a white oak handle, a 3 or 4 stainless steel spatula head, 2 LED lights, and a bottle opener for your Coke bottles. Now, the current product out there, they have just a plastic handle with just like one light flash bulb on it. And what we wanted to do is make it different, but also more durable. So we made sure to use a stainless steel switch, stainless steel head, and also make sure to keep that battery drop-down feature. Next, please. So I'll go into a bit about our process. So here's our display board, and this kind of goes into detail as a visualization of how we went through our process. So we originally take a white oak wood board, and then we cut it into long strips, and this will all be shown in our production video. And this is what we start with for our handle. We then drill some holes in it, and route it to get these nice edges that we have, these nice rounded edges, as well as a switch hole. We get it laser engraved, and we also put some channels in here for all the circuitry and split it. And then next, we'll stain it, put a switch in it, and package it up. Now, we didn't come to this process right away. I'm sure every team has a lot of lessons learned on prototyping, and we eventually decided that we definitely want to come with a product all the collectively together that we were really proud of. That was one of our biggest attributes. Some people thought profit was important, but collectively as a team, we thought that something that we'd be proud of, that was simply just cool, was going to be really important.
So now to talk about packaging, this is what our package looks like. And the reason we went with this package design was we wanted something that displayed our product fully, so that when the customer walked up to it, they really had a chance to interact with the product, kind of see how it works, see if they like it, and then make their decision whether or not to buy it. So something that's a little bit subtle is we have a 1.9 degree angle on these pillars that we have supporting the product. The reason behind that was that we wanted something that kind of mimicked the shape of the spatula as it went down the package, so it kind of gives it a more like seamless look. The base cavity that we have at the bottom is what we use to cover up the end plug so that it's, you know, not in the way when somebody's trying to hold it. And then that brings us into our package testing. So we brought our product through ISTA 6 FedEx A testing, as a lot of groups did. And what we actually tested with was an old spatula that was, it was sort of like a working prototype. And what we found was that there were some issues with the switch afterwards, as well as the battery casing. And so because we got those test results, we added some padding into the packaging and we kind of refined our design to make it a little bit more rigid. And then we brought it through the testing again, and that's when we had our success. And then for shipping it, basically what we did is we put this inside of a slid lock top box, and then we put those cushions in that I was talking about. And with that, that brings us into the finances. So our sales were mostly done through the website. We put them online. We contacted some friends and family that we wanted to have first access to our spatula. And then after that, we were planning on selling the rest, but we actually sold everything in 36 hours, which we were really happy about. And that kind of eliminated our need to push any more sales after that. In terms of profit and loss analysis, we were looking at products that cost us about $30 to manufacture. But we had some issues with switches, with wood, and because of that, we were at that $30 point, and that brought us to a break even at selling about 85 spatulas. So what we found was that if we were to scale this up in the future, we'd be able to trim our prices down to about $20. And so selling at $40, that's making $20 for every spatula that we sell.
Right. So as we went through this process, as everybody's probably found out, this is absolutely a learning curve. There's a huge learning curve, and we took a lot with us from this class. Our biggest lesson learned right out the gate was effective communication. We've been blessed with our group to have a lot of really, really passionate people in this group that are really excited about it. But the one thing that we've ran into, and I'll be the first one to take note of this, is that we all came together with ideas, and we ran into the issue where no one was necessarily wrong, but no one was necessarily right. And how do you get past that barrier? So trying to find good ways to solve problems on like stylistic choices or the things that there isn't a right or wrong answer was a huge thing for us. I know when we were looking at features for our product, we came up with a lot of our answers through market research and going and getting the voice of the customer. That too proved to be a valuable lesson for us going forward. As for people management, we experienced, again, a lot of hours together, a lot of time together, and I would say one of the biggest successes is the fact that we can still talk and hang out with each other and not hate each other, for sure, because people management, we spent so much time, we had so many different ideas, and we all, made mistakes. There's no doubt, we all made mistakes, and so trying to understand that when we make a mistake, we all make a mistake, and getting that sort of collective unit buy-in was a big thing for us, but we were able to do that and come together as a team, which I personally believe to be our biggest success as a group. But back to like the business side of things, our big lesson learned was having effective supplier relations. We struggled on procuring our switches. We went through plan A, plan B, and plan C came up short. So understanding that it's not all in your control, but you got to put yourself in a position to be successful by working with someone that you trust, and that's within our group and also within the suppliers that work in the outside world. So those are our big takeaways. As for our future business scale up,
so that sounds like it wasn't so much relations, but it was finding the right supplier. So you should have had relations.
So yeah, we tried to order from China, and our switches from China, we were getting a really great price, and that was awesome, but then the shipment got seized by customs and never made it out of the port. So we found out that 2 weeks after we were supposed to like have them in-house, which was tough because you email, you don't get anything there. So establishing a supplier relation would have been great, because at least even if they're going to have that issue, we would know about it. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, as for our future business scale-up, we have a market. That's the thing that was really, really exciting. I feel like our sales team did an incredible job, and it was almost painful to be on the sales team because you spent your time telling people no rather than telling people yes. We have a bunch of people that are really excited about that product, and so with the possibility of scaling up, we know that our customers are there. However, our big challenges in getting there are based on the labor, that's the extensive time that we had in lab and within our processes. It would definitely take a production redesign to scale up to higher numbers, because I can tell you that we put in so many hours, so many late nights, that we're kind of designed that way. But if we had more time to go through the prototyping stage, if we had more time to develop a system that could get units out quickly, there would be a possibility for us to scale up in the future. All right, and so for improvements on our product and our process, one of our big things that we found out is we found ourselves struggling with inventory management. As Chad was walking you through all the different pieces and all the different components, once you start a batch, things change, your inventory changes, your work in progress changes, and so understanding where everything is and how the production is flowing through our system was something that we struggled with. Now, we were able to keep it all together, but knowing exactly where everything was at was something that we didn't have 20/20 vision on at all times. So we would definitely look to develop a better inventory management system. Again, we've already talked about using trusted suppliers and giving them the adequate lead time. So that's something that we would look for, making sure we had set up before we did another production run. And then also a work-life balance. I talked about our group dynamic before, but our group dynamic worked really, really well because people were super committed to this group. But I know that we made a lot of sacrifices for this class, and trying to find a better work-life balance would be a big part of that process redesign, because we could then, you know, live healthier lives where we have time to, you know, for ourselves and time to do the other things in life that we really care about. So those were the things that we would take away from our run at 407 if we were going to do it again. So, all right. With that, I'd like to open up the floor for anyone who has any questions.
Yeah. Can I put in my dishwasher?
You cannot put it in your dishwasher, but if you put anything with wood in your dishwasher, that'll go awesome. So, I wouldn't do that. Yes, sir.
What was like the most labor-intensive part? I mean, I know building the whole thing, but what was
tapping the handle?
Tapping the handle.
Tapping the handle.
What?
We have a broken tap.
Oh, we don't have.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So we have a. We broke a tap wrench. We hand tapped all these battery cores, so like all this threading, we did that ourselves in the vise. And so we ended up breaking one tap wrench, just snapped in half, and we broke one like tap as well that just snapped in half. So blood, sweat, and tears were for sure poured into this product, there's no doubt.
But on the plus side, our forearms are jacked right now.
But the thing about like improving that is we did initially try it on the lathe, which has been the suggestion we've been getting from people, is to try and lathe out the tapping process. And what we found is that it didn't pass our quality specs. We had really, really tight tolerances for keeping a quality product. That goes back to our goals at the beginning, is we wanted to have something we were really proud of. And so when we were doing it on the lathe, Phil had an experience where the piece got ripped out of the chuck, and that was all kinds of unsafe, so we threw that out of the window. And we also had a time where we were able to do it slow enough but it bored out the hole so wide that we had a really loose tolerance for the cap, for the end plug. So that was definitely something that we decided that I'd rather do it right and work harder at it than just take the easy way out. So, yeah, that was to make labor at. Yeah, right.
So, you guys sold out in 36 hours. That's freaking awesome.
Thank you.
First of all, were there a lot of those like online salespeople you didn't know? So, did you end up shipping those, or how did you guys end up doing that?
So, what ended up happening is that we kind of had an idea that these would sell fast, but we wanted to make sure that it would open up to family and friends at first, so we sent it to a select few, but they just sent it to their friends and family, and then it just kind of just spread by itself, and we actually had to put a cap on it because it just spread too fast. So what happened is that, yes, we reached out to the close immediate people to us, and then eventually just reached out to other people.
So did you end up shipping those?
Yeah.
Like, because one of the problems we ran into is we also said we would ship, and then we kind of stuck our foot in our mouth there, and we're just like, well, we don't want to ship to Hawaii. That's like $20 a piece, you know? So did you guys run into a similar problem?
So with shipping, do you want to talk about shipping?
Yeah, so basically what we decided in terms of shipping is that with our profit margin, that would cut out most of our profit on our spatulas, so we decided to pass off shipping costs to customers. Most of the people that bought it, we had like relatively close access to, so we were able to hand deliver them. But there's about 15 or so that we have to ship, or had to ship, and so those ones we passed the cost off to the customer, they were okay with it, and so we just sent it out to them that way. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Any other questions?
So is there a production video?
Yes.
Yeah,
that's what we got there.
Yeah. Go for it.
One question is, I heard the packing referred to as a lot of different terms.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
I think
I
named everything in a way that you guys should remember it.
Right.
Nice.
So, the back end. We developed plenty of different names. We used a lot of the different things that we learned through our GEs, you know, whether it be anatomy class or anything else like that. But we were able to develop pretty professional names after our, you know, 2,000 hours spent on this project.
If you want the name, take a look at our BOM later on.
Anybody else? We do have to hit this production video. Yeah? No? All right.
Chad.
Good question, though. I appreciate it. Uh-oh. There it is. Thank you.